The following program was produced by the Theosophical Society in America.
Muy buenos días, queridos amigos y amigas.
Good morning, everyone.
Es para mí un verdadero honor,
dear friends,
estar con ustedes y compartir
it's an honor
en este evento
to be with you
unas cuantas palabras
and share
acerca del tema
some words with you.
Que en esta vez vamos y hemos estado trabajando en este congreso. Gracias
Since
por la hospitalidad
we've worked very hard in
a
this,
la sociedad
for this congress success. Thank you for all the hospitality of the American section and all of you for being
desde
here.
Desde que empezó esta manifestación, de alguna manera, compartimos el viaje evolutivo. Pero para nosotros, hoy, vamos a conversar un poco sobre la parte
Let us
que
converse
nos toca
today.
Como miembros de la sociedad teosófica. Egoísmo.
That part,
esa
that
es la esencia de estar en un
selfishness
estado de oscuridad,
is the essence of being in darkness, the I and the mind.
En el trabajo esencial
Ms. Radha Burnier, the essential work of the Theosophical Society.
Es lo más representativo del estado de oscuridad,
selfishness is the most representative state of darkness.
Del
since it represents the culminating point at which the soul has fallen into matter, and it is the expression of the grand heresy, separateness. However, it is also the point of return, the pilgrimage towards unity in a conscious way. As we know, humanity has a glorious future of which some great souls have already attained and which we can come to know through study and experience through that portal opened in 1875 by the masters of the Trans-Himalayan White Brotherhood called the Theosophical Society. Then in this journey initiated by humanity from the moment the monastic principle was activated, from darkness to radiant light, and with the character of desperate enterprise, the Theosophical Society was born. The Theosophical Society is a product of the necessity to offer humanity the opportunity to come nearer to the spiritual knowledge, which is non-dogmatic, removing the fetters of superstition and fanatism, and which seeks to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity, capable of overcoming the external differences of every kind, inspiring members to reach that knowledge of the unity of life so that it becomes a living experience instead of a philosophic postulate. Therefore, the TS constitutes an effort, an intent in this journey to the light to bring together those who are willing to humanize their natures with compassion toward the whole humanity and to all sentient beings, said in the Mahama Letters number 8, Spanish edition. And in this resides our great experience as members of the TS to share the journey in becoming compassionate, wiser, loving, fraternal, for the betterment of humanity and for ourselves. We are a definite nucleus with a living project based on the unity of life, whose human expression is found in brotherhood, which involves us in a task of spiritual regeneration of humanity through ways of self-transformation and service guided by our motto, there is no religion higher than truth, and with tolerance and mutual respect for each other. Mrs. Radha Burnier, in respect to the essential work of the Theosophical Society, has said, the Theosophical Society should always be one in which people cooperate together and whose works have the same importance. In India, there are temples with thousands of pillars, and each one is important because it helps to sustain the weight. The TS should be like this. A lecturer should not feel more important than the others. It is not so much what we do, but the spirit in which it's done. How the mind and inner self realize it. When this quality is present, then its energy affects everyone around. If this transformation does not occur, we will not be able to make such an influence. We as members need to work for the liberation of mind. Then we will become capable of transmitting the Theosophical teachings and carrying out its true work. End of quote. As a result, we have common goals and responsibilities along with our particular duties. Along with our particular duties established by an external and inner founders, with whom we have our karmic link more or less strong, depending on the degree of earnestness and way of life, with our spiritual practice and motivations that generate our activities in our various planes of existence, physical, emotional, mental, and spiritual. And this occurs whether we are awake or asleep, or in the company of friend or loved ones, or with beings with whom we directly or indirectly interact. Karma has brought us together in this path. Our journey now points to the right direction, to search and revere truth, whose common purpose is to bring us to the point of expressing the light. This is a joint effort which we had probably started in past lives. And now in this life, we're simply retaking those works which were temporarily interrupted. To share the journey is an opportunity to serve the cause of humanity, the cause which the Master Founders have talked about in their letters. That is why the TS was founded. For the amelioration of pain and ignorance, to bring about loving and spiritual impulses, to be, as it were, a torch of light amidst the forces of materialism, dogmatism, and spiritualism, and cruelty. Therefore, we should count on those appropriate elements which will allow us to walk on this path with success. And success means power to effectively contribute in the awakening process, enlightenment, and self-transformation of humanity. This is spiritual awakening is for everyone.
Esos elementos necesarios básicamente podemos centrarlos en nuestro esfuerzo cotidiano.
We should focus the necessary elements in our daily living.
Procurar ser mejores seres
in order, one, to lift the theosophical teachings, become better human beings as we get closer and closer to our spiritual prototype.
Purificar incesantemente nuestros motivos.
Incessantly purify our motives. Study those great truths to which we have access. Diffuse adequately theosophy. Have present in our minds that we are carekeepers of the TS, as we not only do our work, but appreciate the precious diamond that our society has hidden within, and which we have to polish more and more each time.
A que esta sociedad se mantenga asistida por otros trabajadores,
and allow other workers to do our work in our society.
Vivir las enseñanzas teosóficas parece simple, pero la transformación
to live the theosophical
de
teachings, it looks simple, but the transformation of character, way of thought, feeling and action is arduous. It is easier to accomplish a feat that is externally recognized than, for example, to be humble. We need to recognize our own mistakes and try to mend them. Be tolerant and respectful of everyone and be discreet. Be better human beings. We all want to be better and make the effort to improve. This implies to know oneself and to recognize that which is convenient to the spiritual growth and to do it. We also need to help one another and allow both learning and teaching to take place when we are together. We need to purify incessantly our motives. Our intentions generally seem good and correct. But if we look closer, sometimes we find that we have taken the wrong turns, not only in our private lives, but in our relations with our fellow members and with the mission and attitude towards large meetings and the society itself. To study the great truths that we have access to and to share them. It is not enough to have good intentions and great ideals. As we are involved with the TS movement, we have adopted a way which requires knowledge, the right knowledge, in order to effect the change that we long for ourselves and humanity. This also requires a self-discipline, which in turn will aid us in acquiring this knowledge that will make us really effective and useful. Diffuse adequately the theosophy. It is our responsibility not only to obtain the correct knowledge, but also to transmit it to others. That is why the TS was formed, to work for the enlightenment and benefit of humanity, as it is said in the Muhammad Letters, number 62. The TS, as a vehicle, needs human beings that can embody their ideals and mission. The best diffusion of Theosophy can be made through our relationships with one another and with the environment. In addition, as members of the TS, we are called upon to find the best ways to express the Theosophical teachings and to maintain a great interest in its study and practice. We are the keepers of the TS. The honor and merit to have found in this incarnation the TS and to have found you again in this institution gives us the responsibility to affirm and carry out its objectives, especially in establishing the first object of the TS, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity. We should establish a true fraternity without regard to time and place or circumstance, but as a willful act of belonging to the TS. Together, we can accomplish this because when we are useful to the TS, we are useful to humanity as a whole. Finally, allow other workers to continue our work. We are only passing through on this earth. One of our tasks is to help the next generation of members to assume their duties in a way that it resonates well in their hearts, in addition to giving them the necessary knowledge. We must pass the baton to the next fellow worker. Remember that the Mahatma KH exhorted the old members to give a hand to the new ones, helping them in their quest and journey. Brotherhood is a singular cornerstone as a way to progress. The universal brotherhood as principle and purpose of the TS should serve to check whether our lives are in accordance with this object of the TS. Since we have made a serious commitment when we signed the membership papers, by becoming members, we have undertaken the journey to bring the light of truth shine without obstacles. The Master says that the term universal brotherhood is not a hollow phrase. It is the only fundamental principle that permits universal morality. If this were a dream, at least it would be a noble one for humanity. And this is the true aspiration of the true adept. With the great foresight and virtue of the great ones, for the love of humanity, they chose and brought together Henry Steele Alcott and Madame Blavatsky to found the society. Today, we pilgrims are not alone, and we share the mission. We have the profound truths and the portal lay open which shows the way. Altruism, pure altruism as we traverse the way. Altruism to dissipate the shadow. Altruism to unite with the light. Why? Quote, altruism is an essential part of our development. And because the future of the TS will depend almost on the level of altruism, devotion, and selflessness. And lastly, but not least, it will depend upon the knowledge and wisdom of those members to whom the work and leadership will fall upon after the death of its founders.
HPB.
The key to Theosophists. For us, Theosophists, sharing the journey of darkness to light means that we agree with our ideals. But as we are not perfect yet, but aspire to become it, the Mahamas have a word of hope for us. Try. And yes, we shall try. Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. We're very grateful to Teresina, to Betty Bland, and all and everyone who has made this possible, this beautiful event that we are having, sharing the journey. Even though in the ultimate reality, all of us are one, and there's only one life, one spirit, one force, yet during the pilgrimage of the universal manifestation, we appear separate and different. Every consciousness that manifests itself through material vehicles in the lower planes, unless it had in previous manvantaras attained complete self-consciousness of his essential being and dominion of all the laws that govern the expression of the Sakti aspect of the Absolute at those levels, it remains subject and limited to these vehicles and forgives completely inside these envelopes his real source and potentialities, his reason of existence, the purpose of the divine mind when bringing him to this evolution plan, etc. When the entity in evolution is in the form subject to this ignorant state, he has lost the normal state of beatitude, the essential characteristic of the real being. And because such integrated consciousness has lost its primary condition and is reduced to the mental capacity that exclusively expresses itself in these vehicles, it experiences pain and even desperation, trying then to fulfill the satisfaction of sensations, which become the substitutes of the natural and intrinsic state of real happiness. This entity residing in these material vehicles and inexhaustibly finding constant pleasure in place of the real Ananda, which has become difficult to realize as its mother's the expression of life and mind in these lower levels. And as such, he can never put an end to the pain he's trying to evade or obtain the lost beatitude. All of us know, at least intellectually, the importance of Patanjali's doctrine of the kleshas, developed so masterly in the second book of the Yoga Sutras. But few have considered how profoundly it is related with the interconnectedness of all lines of evolution which we have passed and will continue to traverse in this upward journey. Nobody is really isolated. No one can elevate or fall without affecting the whole, and that is the most essential spiritual truth. This mutual interrelationship is more evident and almost impossible to ignore when we aspire to tread the spiritual path. The higher the expression of life, the more it will affect positively or negatively the rest of those who are closely evolving in the system. The success or the temporal failures of every human being is the success or the temporal failure in some measure of all. The symbol of the chain in Masonic symbolism is used to remind us of the duty of helping one another. It is also the symbol of the duty of every person who attains some elevation to extend his helpful hand to all that are beneath him, and not only to those that are at the same level of existence. In addition, every false step that we make and every degradation in which we participate affects the lives of those weaker ones around us. In Light of Asia, Sir Erwin Arnold tells us the following. And so holy was the influence of that high dawn which came with victory, that far and near, in homes of men, there spread an unknown peace. The slayer hid his knife. The robber laid his plunder back. The shroff full tale of coins. All evil hearts grew gentle, kind hearts gentler, as the balm of that divinest daybreak lightened earth. Kings at fierce war called truce. The sick men leaped laughing from beds of pain. The dying smiled as though they knew that happy morn was sprung from fountains farther than the utmost east. And over the heart of sad Jahodara, sitting forlorn at Prince Siddhartha's bed, came sudden bliss as if love should not fail, nor such vast sorrow miss to end in joy. So glad the world was, though it wist not why, that over desolate waste went swooning songs of mirth, the voice of bodily spirits and Buddhas, foreseeing Buddha, and devas in the air cried, "It is finished, finished." And the priest stood with the wondering people in the streets, watching those golden splendors flood the sky and saying, there has happened some mighty thing. Also, in Ran and Jungle grew that day friendship amongst the creatures. Spotted deer browsed fearless where the tigress fed her cubs. And cheetahs lapped the pool beside the bucks. Under the eagle's rock, the brown hare scoured, while his fierce beak but preened an idle wing. The snake sunned all his jewels in the beam with deadly fangs in sheath. The shrike led past the nestling finch, the emerald alcyons sate dreaming while the fishes played beneath, nor hawked the merops. Though the butterflies, crimson and blue and amber, flitted thick around his perch, the spirit of our Lord lay potent upon man and bird and beast, even while he mused under that bodhi tree. End of the quote. In Isaiah's book, we see predicted the state of harmony between all beings and creatures in the 11th chapter, versicles 6-9, which is similar to the previous narration of flight of Asia. They both point to the one reality, we shall manifest itself plainly and irrevocably when the human evolution shall attain its definite height. The effect upon humanity of Lord Buddha's illumination and upon other kingdoms in nature is not an exception or miracle, but the maximum expression of the ever-present unity that pervades all. This is applicable to every function of the laws in the universe. Karma, for example, doesn't function exclusively in one person. It can be explained as a simple relation of cause and effect if one looks at it only in one particular way. We can really designate it as individual or personal karma, collective, etc. But it's really the interplay of all the vibrations, as much of cause as of effect, which affect the unity of life in every different ways. At every level or center of manifestation, but always in a very real sense. Every thought, feeling, action, any movement apparently bounded functions in the boundless, absolute, abstract movement that HPB used to symbolize the absolute reality, which never changes, never increases or decreases, because its integrity and its always non-manifested reality cannot be altered. Then, when we talk about sharing in any sense, we only are trying to be conscious of one reality which we don't recognize in our present state of mental evolution, but that is ever present in multiple forms, now unknown or unconscious for us in our consciousness. The reason for which every human being must evolve by himself, and that nothing or no one can help to elude this responsibility, is clearly based on that great paradox that life is one, and even though all manifestation appears like an infinite series of centers of expression, and not only each one is unique in its function, all are inextricably interdependent and united beyond any mental conception. When HPB in the proem of the Secret Doctrine presents the idea of this one life, she explains that we cannot try to obtain a proof of its reality by a mere intellectual exercise of imagining many things very close together, like we can think of soldiers making up a closely knit army. All comparison with the parts or portions that form a conglomerate which we see in the physical plane as acting as units are not enough to imagine this transcendent unity. It is very difficult to have a good relationship and to share with all. The great difficulty in living this practice in accordance with our essential unity lies, as explained in I.K. Timney's Glimpses into the Psychology of Yoga, quote, the lower self is not something independent of and apart from the monad. The same reality and the same consciousness which lies at the root of the monad is also at the root of the personality. The only difference is that in the case of the personality, the reality is more involved in matter, and thus the consciousness is more encumbered with limitations and illusions. These are partly inherent in the nature of the planes, and partly the result of the distortions and undesirable tendencies present in the mind owing to its ignorance and lack of spiritual unfoldment. The lower self may be considered to be that aspect of the personality which is the product of the latter. In other words, finishes the quotation, the lower self is nothing but the mind working in the limitations and illusions of the lower worlds. And with all the distortions and undesirable tendencies which are created as a result of those illusions. End of quote. To share the path is to pass from the mental levels of relationship in which we are now involved and ascend through those levels of consciousness wherein the essential unity is more and more perceived and realized. This ascension is a gradual process whereby the unity and harmony, the beatitude and the light are not obscured by the function of the lower vehicles. This process brings us to the realization of our intrinsic relationship with all beings and all creatures. In other words, it fulfills the law.
Well, oops. I have to say that it is indeed an honor to share this journey with these two very fine people, Maria de Los Angeles Orlick and Gaspar Torres. Particularly Gaspar, after the quite difficult ordeal we had in having the opportunity to get him here. So it's a privilege to even share the stage with you. Thank you. Also, I recognize that I am from the South and speak slowly anyway, but the translator has asked me to speak even more slowly. So you may be able to understand more of what I say in English, and also this will help our translator. I would like to start in thinking about our journey, talk about a story of a bird in a cage. And this bird in the cage sat by the window and looked outside and saw other birds flying free. And the bird longed and longed to have the freedom to fly freely in the sky. So one day, as the bird in the cage was sitting in an open window, a man with a beard, who was a very wise old meditative teacher, walked by and saw the bird in the cage. And he recognized that the bird was wishing to be free. So he told the bird, if you will just meditate, you can be free. But you have to focus with all of your mind, all of your being. You can't eat, you can't sleep. All you can do is meditate. It has to be the one focus of your life. And so the bird thought, well, I'll give it a try. So the bird meditated and meditated, and he was almost in a stupor because he was so hungry and hadn't gotten much sleep either. But finally, he fell into a trance. And his owner came along and saw the bird sitting there lifeless, and he shook the cage, and the bird fell on the floor and still didn't wake up. And the owner said, oh my, this bird is dead. We'll throw him out and get another one. And so he took the bird out into the garden and dumped the cage so that the bird fell into the garden. And there was the bird out in the garden. Well, after a while, maybe a gentle shower woke the bird up. And the bird was amazed. There was no more cage. He was free. It had worked. And so after a few joyous flights in air around in circles, he flew by various other caged birds in the window. And, oh, he was just very adamant. He went to those birds and to each window, and chirping all the while, he told them, if you will just meditate, you have to concentrate totally, but if you meditate hard enough, that cage will disappear. Well, of course, that wouldn't always be the case. Sometimes we don't fully understand our own journey or our own experiences. And then we tend to think ours is the only way. And so we try to force that on other people and tell them, just really are very intense about it and insist that they must try it our way because everything will soon be clear if they try it our way. Well, this is an interesting story that can tell us a lot. I think one of the first elements, and I know that Maria mentioned that, and we have heard it mentioned several times as we have worked together in our groups already. Humility is one of the first qualities that we have when we share with each other, that we have to recognize we do not have all the answers. We do not understand what another person is dealing with. And consciousness is an amazing thing. It is experienced in so many ways and very hard to control and very hard even to identify what it is we're experiencing. So I would say a concomitant with humility is dana, or the first of the paramitas, or charity. And charity in this sense is a gentleness and kindness of spirit. And that is an essential part of sharing the journey with each other. Now, I think about sharing this journey as both as of two kinds. We share the journey as traveling with another, and that is an important aspect of it. I like to use the word sangha, and it is used in Buddhist terminology a lot. And that means community, a spiritual community, a supportive community. And I think that that is a word that should enter into the theosophical vocabulary. We have a lot of strange words. Why not add another one? And I think that is a beautiful word to always think that we are in spiritual community. That is the traveling with or companionable relationship. And the other part of sharing the journey is communicating toward others, letting other people know about the value of this shared journey. And so as we think about what we might share, I can see our journey as being as relating well to the three-legged stool that we mention very often in theosophical terms, and that is study, meditation, and service. That is the aspect of the journey. That is our three-legged, we're a three-legged creature as we walk along in our journey, and that is what we share with others. And each of these aspects is an inner, has an inner and an outer aspect to it. For instance, in study, one of the most important things is to study ourselves. We have to begin to understand what our cage is and how we either deal with it or miraculously get out of it. But ultimately, we are the ones who have to see what that is and how to work with it. Other people can give us hints, but only we ourselves can truly understand and begin the work. But that is where Sangha comes in very importantly, because study also has an outward aspect, and it's not only studying the various writings that we have of major teachers, but it is interfacing with other people, because only as we interface with other people can we begin to have a sense of what we're learning. We need a mirror. We need that reflection of another consciousness. And so that is a sharing in the Sangha way, but it is a study. And for service, even service, there's an inner aspect to service, which is as we can build any quality of peace, any quality of loving kindness, any quality of gentleness, as we can build these into ourselves, then that creates an atmosphere that helps all beings. And so even by that inner work, we are doing a great service. And then, of course, it's easy to recognize what outer service is, but outer service is not true service unless it is imbued with that inner quality. And, of course, the linchpin is meditation. And I would say that meditation also has that inner and outer quality. The inner quality, of course, we know. It's that seeking that inner peace, that inner connection, that inner stillness. And again, the support of the Sangha helps us in that if we meditate together, which I think is such an important aspect of all of our groups, is that group meditation. And I'm so glad, grateful to Teresina for setting it up and grateful for Maria to teach the meditation class in the afternoon so that we have the chance to experience that support of each other together. And then, but the outer aspect of meditation is that always we're responsible to transmit that sense of peace and healing and light out to the rest of the world. And so these are the characteristics of the journey that we're walking and what we are both sharing in Sangha, in group, as well as transmitting to others. When we do this, we will be transmitting to others in the right way, being present with them in sensitivity. And then miraculously, that cage will disappear in some way for ourselves and for our companions. And it's really an interesting thing that it's not of our own doing. It's like the owner who came and dumped the bird out of the cage. There is something miraculous that happens that we cannot control. It unfolds from within, and a little bit at a time, each one of us finds bits of that cage dropping away, and as we support in each other in that, that is our journey to gradually lose that cage. Thank you. That's all.